One Without the Other, written and narrated by Shelley Moore. Dedication for Lauren Bodine. Foreword. Why do we do what we do? What is the legacy we leave as educators? These are questions I have been wondering about lately. As an inclusive educator who is passionate about social justice and equity, teaching is not just a job, it's a passion. It's a vehicle to make a difference, not just in the classroom, but in our communities and society. This book makes such a contribution. Through story and metaphor, Shelley touches the heart and helps us to embrace diversity and move towards greater equity in our classrooms. Educators need inspiration. We need new ways to consider and renew our practice. Shelley Moore's work provokes us. It illustrates how we can align our values and practice. It's hard to argue with a concept of inclusion, but what does it really mean? What can it look like? Shelley's work takes up concepts such as Universal Design for Learning, or UDL. With the sweeper van, Shelley helps us deepen our understanding of UDL. She's right. We all need increased support at different points in our lives. With humor and gravitas, Shelley shows that how and when these supports are put into place for some, they can benefit many. With stories like Presuming Competence, Shelley illustrates how students who provoke and challenge us offer us the opportunity to move into the unknown and develop our pedagogy. With this book, Shelley brings this point home time and time again. Shelley was and is that student for me. She has helped me to see students as more than a snapshot. I've come to know Shelley through many lenses. I was Shelley's teacher in grade 8 and 9 in Edmonton, and then again during her master's work at Simon Fraser University. And now I work with her as a PhD student. I also know her as a teacher and co-researcher and friend. As I taught and learned with Shelley over these past 3 decades, she has offered me many a telling moment. Her questions, protestations, risk-taking, and creativity have helped me to see teaching and learning in new ways. Her teaching, learning, and research extend the ideas I take up in my scholarship. This is why I do what I do. What is my legacy? It's seeing my students surpass what I could only dream. It's seeing the next generation of innovators like Shelley reimagine and recognize social justice and equity in profound new ways that change outcomes for students who are on the outside pins, and showing how inclusive classrooms can increase the learning and life chances of all students. Wrapped up in these stories and metaphors are practices and insights to provoke and inspire. This book documents the beginnings of Shelley's legacy. Enjoy the metaphors, stories, perspectives, and learning that accompany One Without the Other. Leyton Schellert, PhD, Faculty of Education, University of British Columbia, Okanagan. Introduction. I was teaching a course last summer at the University of British Columbia called Conceptual Foundations of Inclusive Education. 30 or so practicing teachers from various subject areas, knowledge, expertise, and experience levels from across British Columbia joined me for 3 weeks of deconstruction, inquiry, and reflection, creating an engaging community of learners. The course was in July, and on this particular day, it was my birthday. We started the class with some cupcakes and hung up happy birthday bunting across the whiteboard before diving into our explorations and understanding of the concept driving learning systems all over the world, inclusive education. I showed a slide to my students with 4 bubbles, see figure 1.1, page 2. Their job was to label the bubbles with the appropriate terms, inclusion, integration, exclusion, and segregation, based on their own experiences and prior knowledge of the concepts. After some discussion, it was agreed that bubble C, in fact, represented inclusion. See figure 1.2, page 3. This is the common consensus arrived at in many groups I have worked with, both in pre- and in-service professional development settings. After some discussion, however, a student commented, "Shelley, I don't think this diagram is inclusion either." This caught me off guard. Of course this is inclusion, I thought. I had shown the slide to hundreds, if not thousands, of people. What could she possibly mean? Figure 1.1, a diagram consisting of four bubbles and dots. The dots are one of four designs, either wavy, checkered, diamond, or striped. The bubbles are labeled A, B, C, and D. Bubble A is filled with wavy dots and has an outer circle of the other three types of dots. Bubble B is filled with wavy dots, but also contains a smaller circle with a cluster of the three other types of dots. Bubble C mostly has wavy dots, with a couple of each other type of dot randomly mixed in. Bubble D has only wavy dots inside the bubble, and has a cluster of the other three types of dots in a circle off to the side. Figure 1.2. An identical diagram to figure 1.1, except the bubbles have been reordered and relabeled. Bubble A has been labeled exclusion. Bubble B has been labeled integration. Bubble C has been labeled inclusion. Bubble D has been labeled segregation. She explained, "Look what you've shown us. I see a bubble with a whole bunch of wavy dots, and then there are a scattered handful of other pattern dots." "Yeah," I said, "and?" "Well, in my definition of inclusion, there is no other." I stood there speechless because she was absolutely right. The diagram I was presenting was not one of inclusion. It was an example of the traditional model of education. The model where our goal is to produce more of the same. Lingering evidence of the factory model of education, where we need to produce and replicate people to meet the demand of the workforce during the Industrial Revolution. A model where our job as educators, and especially special educators, is to identify students who aren't wavy and fix them. Send the checkered kids to the checkered teacher, the diamond kids to the diamond teacher, the striped kids to the striped teacher. This model of education is a deficit medical model. And I was showing the class a perfect example of how it was still plaguing us today. But more and more kids are coming to us, not wavy. Not only is this model less effective, but also we're running out of funding supports and students to allow this model to continue. Some have met this shift in paradigm with panic. Others are seeing it as an opportunity. This paradigm shift, however, is long overdue, and we need to start matching our goals of education to the goals and expectations needed to meet the current demands of our society, which no longer wants people to simply comply. This is especially true now, as more and more occupations involving compliance and replication are being replaced by machines. Educational reforms are happening on a global scale, including in British Columbia and other provinces in Canada, where the ministries of education are completely restructuring their curricula, being designed and written by teachers for teachers, with the emphasis on moving away from classrooms of wavy students. BC Ministry of Education, 2015. We are no longer living in the Industrial Revolution. This is the 21st century, where we need to value the strengths rather than deficits in learning. Rather than finding out why students aren't wavy, our job is now to find what their pattern is. What do they bring? What can they contribute because of their diverse and unique expertise? For decades, we have been trying to take this pattern out of our students, taking the special out of special education, the autistic out of autism, the language out of cultures, and especially the Indigenous out of First Nations, Métis, and Inuit children. This is not teaching to diversity. This is not inclusive. Teaching to diversity and inclusion is where we value the characteristics that are diverse and not try and homogenize them. The class continued to discuss what the conceptual diagram of inclusion could be, and together we decided that the only way to ensure there was no other was not to make us all wavy, but instead to make us all another. See figure 1.3. Figure 1.3, a diagram of a circle filled with dots. Each dot has a unique pattern. When looking at inclusion this way, it also helped us to realize that this is no longer an idea specific to special education. There is a distinct gap between the silos of special education and curriculum. But if we look at inclusion as a concept of teaching to diversity of all, rather than a special education initiative, we can bridge this gap.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.